The only reason I know who Stone Sour was because they used to play that one music video on Fuse, and it was like, oh, that's what the guy from Slipknot looks like. That's cool. Like, I don't know how... Sorry, I don't know how into Slipknot y'all were in, like, the early 2000s, which was when I first started listening, but there was always, like, this huge, like, online thing where it was just, like, what do the members actually look like? And everyone knew what Corey Taylor looked like, but the rest would be, like, weird, like, fake Photoshopped images of, like, what they thought the unmasked versions of the rest of the members looked like.
Yeah. So, just for your knowledge, Teddy, as we continue with this, I've been researching by reading a couple of books by, Joel McIver and Jason Arnop are the, like, music journalist guys who wrote about Slipknot. And they were writing this sort of, like, I think the books came out in, like, 2001. So, like, right before Iowa came out. And they did write a little bit about that, how, like, the guys made a pretty good effort to, like, stay masked whenever they were, like... visibly in public, and people it's really cool. didn't it, know what they looked like.
It builds a lore. I mean, it was something that I was googling on like a fucking like dial-up connection.
And to answer your question, Evan and I were not into Slipknot until we saw them with you.
Dial-up on the Weezer message boards, like speculating about Rivers Cuomo's love life.
Oh damn.
I was on Lego.com at the time.
Look, the Lego website used to be fucking sick.
That's much cooler.
Yeah, I remember the exact place I was when I listened to Slipknot for the first time. I was in middle school. The way that our middle school worked was you had to stand outside when you got dropped off by the bus, and then they would let you in when like the doors opened. So each grade stood in a different spot. And when I was in seventh grade, I was standing outside, and one of my friends was like, yo, you have to listen to this band. And then off of one of those fucking like they look like a, like the little pillbox shaped sand disc MP3 players played me Wait and Bleed by Slipknot. And I was like, this is the heaviest band that ever existed. And then like 3 months later, I found out about Mathcore and was like, never mind, but they're still cool.
Yeah. Yeah. And Wait and Bleed is one of the tamer ones on this
album.
Yeah.
I was going to say.
Yeah. But I mean, but it was the biggest one. So it was probably what like a 12-year-old could find on version of LimeWire was out at the time.
Yeah. I mean, very solid for a first single. It is a good song.
Yeah. It's honestly, I revisited this album a lot in order to do the podcast that you are now listening to. But it's a fucking good first album. Like, I don't know if it's the best Slipknot album or like the best album, but as far as like the first attempt of a band with nine people to make a cohesive thing, very impressive.
Yeah. Yeah.
For sure.
Even the songs I don't like that much are like not that bad. You know?
Yeah, I mean, it's a 24-year-old album, 25-year-old album
at
this point.
Like, now. Yeah,
to listen to anything from that era and have it hold up to any degree is impressive.
Yeah.